Imagine that you're organizing a massive competition, let's say a video creation contest with thousands of participants. Of course, at the end, you need to determine the winners. How will you go about it? The problem is that there are thousands of videos and each one can last for more than half an hour. It's impossible for anyone to watch all the videos. Therefore, having a jury is not feasible. Additionally, for the same reason, we cannot organize a traditional vote since nobody has the time to watch all the videos. So, how can we organize a competition? In this video, I explain the algorithm behind the SoME3 voting system, and I hope you like how meta this is since the video itself is part of the competition. We'll talk about graph theory, but there are no prerequisites. If you have some knowledge of linear algebra, it will be useful towards the end of the video, but if not, it can still motivate you to delve deeper. We want to organize a vote to determine the winners. The thing is, each voter only has partial knowledge of all the entries, and the knowledge of the entry's quality should emerge at the group level through the voting process. In fact, that's the role of the vote, and each voter will contribute by exploring a portion of the entries. To make the task easier, the simplest approach is to have voters vote on a pair of entries AB and indicate which one is better, A or B. This way we can add an arrow pointing to the better of the two entries, gradually creating a graph where the vertices represent the entries and the edges represent the votes. But how can we ensure that the vote is fair? We want good properties for our voting process, such as ensuring that no one is favored. This translates into having good properties at the graph level. For example, if we choose pairs of video randomly, here's the type of graph we would obtain. We can observe that some entries receive more vote than others. To achieve fairness in the vote, we want all entries to become paired an equal number of times. A graph that has this property is called a regular graph. For example, this graph is regular because, as you can see, each vertex has three edges. We also notice that there are isolated clusters that are not connected by any direct or indirect votes. Consequently, it becomes impossible to compare entries between these clusters and determine if a video from cluster A is better than a video from cluster B. To avoid this, the graph should always contain a path, even indirect, between any two entries. Such a graph is called connected. So, we already have two criteria that ensure fairness in the vote. If the graph is connected, no group of entry is isolated from the others. And if the graph is regular, each entry receives the same number of votes. The problem is that there are too many possible comparisons. If we aim to compare every entry with each other, then each of the n entries is connected to the other n-1 entries. One might think that there are n times n-1 edges, but to avoid counting each edge twice, AB and BA, we need to divide by 2. Therefore, there are n times n-1 over 2 possible comparisons. Even with 1,000 voters, each person would need to vote approximately 500 times to cover all the comparisons, which is impossible. Thus, inevitably, we'll have to compare certain entries indirectly. For example, if A is stronger than B and B is stronger than C, we'd like to conclude that A is stronger than C. However, for mathematicians, it's not so straightforward. In voting theory, we can encounter situations where a majority of people prefer A over B, a majority prefers B over C, and a majority prefers C over A. To overcome this, we need to make an assumption. We must assume that a ranking of the entries exists. After all, the purpose of the vote is to find or approximate this ranking, and this assumption was implicit until now. However, comparing entries indirectly can lead us to consider long chains. And the longer the transmission chain, the more information degrades, as in the case of the telephone game. Therefore, to improve the reliability of the vote, we'll seek to minimize the length of the comparison chains. For each pair of vertices, we can determine the length of the shortest path connecting them. This gives us a number that characterizes the graph based on the worst-case scenario. For example, here it's always possible to connect two entries in 5 edges or fewer. Therefore, this graph has a diameter of 5. In general, if it's always possible to connect two entries in n edges or fewer, then the graph has diameter n. Hence, we have a third criterion. We look for a graph with a small diameter to ensure that the chains of indirect comparisons are not too long. This may remind you of the small-ruled graph, with the famous 6 degrees of separation between two individuals in a social network. This property is related to the fact that the diameter of a social network is relatively small and serves as the basis for many fun applications. The difference, however, is that in social networks, we have clusters, which mean highly interconnected groups that are less connected to the others. In our case, we want regular graphs, which is quite different. Let's recap. For the vote to be fair, we want the graph to be connected and regular. To increase the reliability of indirect comparisons, we want the graph to have a small diameter to facilitate communication between the entries. And for the entries to be well connected, it's sufficient for the subparts of the graph to be well connected as well. Let's try to quantify this mathematically. Given a subpart S of our graph G, we'll count the number of edges connecting an element of S to an element that's not in S. These edges form what we call the boundary of S, denoted as partial S. We'll construct a number that measures how well S communicates with its complement. To begin, a larger subpart easily has more elements in its boundary. So to measure intrinsically, we'll count the number of edges in the boundary relative to the size of the subpart S. By symmetry, our number also measures how well the complement communicates with S. To achieve this symmetry, we'll take the ratio with respect to the smaller of the two sets, S or its complement. This way, the number measures how well the smaller of the two sets is connected to its complement through their command boundary. This formula is symmetric. Let's call this quantity the expansion ratio of the subpart S. Note that the subpart in question cannot be empty to avoid dividing by zero, so this formula is applicable to any strict subpart of the graph's vertices, but not to the subpart consisting of all vertices or the empty subpart. To obtain a measure of the connectivity of G, we will aggregate the data from the strict subparts of G. There are several ways to aggregate data. We could take an average, a median, etc. However, similar to the case of diameter, we will rely on the worst-case scenario by taking the minimum of the expansion ratios of the strict subparts. This way, we ensure that any given subpart has an expansion ratio better than this number. Let's call this the expansion ratio of G. To better understand this notion, let's look at three examples. In the case of a non-connected graph, we can find a subpart that has no outgoing edges, so its boundary has no elements. Since the expansion ratio of G is a non-negative number and represents the minimum over subparts, we conclude that the expansion ratio of a non-connected graph is zero. This actually gives us a new way to characterize connectivity, and thus, in the context of voting, we are looking for graphs with a non-zero expansion ratio. In the case of a cycle, if we take a semicircle as a subpart, it has a size of n over 2, as does its complement, and it only has two edges in its boundary. Therefore, the expansion ratio of a cycle is less than or equal to 4 over n, and the larger the cycle, the less well connected it is. Before we delve into the case of the complete graph, let's observe that the minimum in the denominator of the formula implies that we always have a number smaller than n over 2 in the denominator. By considering the complement of S, which has the same boundary, we can assume that S is of size less than or equal to n over 2. Therefore, the formula can be rewritten by taking the minimum over strict subparts of size smaller or equal to n over 2. In the case of a complete graph, each element in a subpart of size m is connected to the n minus m elements in its complement. Consequently, there are m times n minus m edges in the boundary. The expansion rate is then a minimum of n minus m when m is less than or equal to n over 2, which yields n over 2. Thus, the expansion rate of a complete graph is high, indicating that a complete graph is well connected. When the expansion rate t is strictly positive, a subpart of size s has more than t times s elements in its boundary. By adding the elements of the boundary to those in s, we obtain a new subpart that is 1 plus t times larger than s. This formula is multiplicative, and by repeating this process n times, we have a subpart whose size grows exponentially. If we apply this reasoning to a subpart consisting of a single element, since the subpart grows exponentially, any other vertex in the graph can be reached relatively quickly. Specifically, the length of a chain connecting any two points is at most on the order of the logarithm of n. Therefore, if the graph has a good expansion rate, its diameter is small, of the order of log of n. Now, we need to create this graph. In our case, we already have the vertices since they correspond to the registered entries. We need to determine the appropriate comparisons between these entries to create a regular graph with a good expansion rate. This is where a beautiful relationship between the expansion rate of a graph and the eigenvalues of its adjacency matrix come into play. The adjacency matrix of a graph is a table that indicates whether vertices are connected. For example, node 0 is connected to nodes 3, 5, and 7, so there are 1s in cells 3, 5, and 7 of row 0. Similarly, node 1 is connected to node 6, 7, and 9, so there are 1s in cells 6, 7, and 9 of row 1, and so on. Note that the sum of the coefficients in each row of the adjacency matrix is equal to 3. 3 is what we call an eigenvalue of the matrix, and it's not a coincidence that it's also the degree of each vertex. Some combinations of the coefficients may yield other eigenvalues, and we learn how to calculate them in linear algebra. The result that follows is incredible. It's called the Cheeger inequality. It provides bounds on the expansion rate of a regular graph based on the first two eigenvalues of its adjacency matrix, where the first eigenvalue is precisely the degree of the graph as we have seen. Therefore, the difference between the degree d and the second eigenvalue measures how good the expansion rate is. To have a good expansion rate for a fixed degree, the second eigenvalue should be as small as possible. The second part of the reasoning involves a theorem by Allen and Boppner, which gives a lower bound for the second eigenvalue in a regular graph. Hence, we know that we cannot do better than this bound, and the graphs that come close to it are the best possible expanders. They are called Ramanujan graphs. The final piece of reasoning is a 118-page proof from 2004 by Joel Friedman, which shows that by taking d over two random cycles, the second eigenvalue is bounded by 2 times the square root of d minus 1 plus epsilon with a high probability. In other words, the expansion rate is close to the bound given by Allen and Boppner. So we have our model. By taking random cycles of size n, we obtain with a high probability the best type of regular expanders. All our criteria are satisfied. The graph is connected, regular, and has small diameter. Moreover, the number of required comparisons is reasonable. For example, to obtain a regular graph of degree 10, we only need to add 5 cycles, and each participant needs to vote only 5 times. All that's left is to conduct the voting and rank the entries on the graph using, for example, Google's PageRank algorithm. I hope you enjoyed this overview. Now you know the key aspects of the algorithm. Many thanks to James and Grant for all the organization. It's thanks to them that this event exists. Now, to conclude and for your enjoyment, I'll provide an animation of the example when n equals 1000. Observe how the diameter drastically decreases with this method.